Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Welcome once again this Saturday. We are glad to have everyone here this morning, and as they're also arriving, we just want to welcome you all and also welcome you all on live stream watching this morning. We just want to welcome you and also to get prepared with your Bibles and perhaps something to write with. And you can also write down the some of the scripture that we're going to share this morning about our lesson. We are in lesson 11, and it is entitled A New Creation.
Pasamos a otros hermanos. Vamos a la lección número 11 en esta mañana. Les damos las bienvenidas que nos acompañan. La lección número 11 que se lleva por nombre Una Nueva Creación. Así que prepare su cuaderno y téngalo abierto para la página 36 y así nos puede seguir en el estudio de esta mañana.
Okay. Let us go into God in prayer before we start our lesson this morning. I'm going to ask Manuel to lead us in prayer.
Vamos a hacer una oración. Father in heaven, we come before you this morning. We want to give you thanks, dear God, for the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. You've given us the life and the strength this morning so that we could be here in your presence. We pray now, Heavenly Father, for your blessing as we continue our study this morning. We ask for the guidance of your Spirit, Lord, that as we search your scriptures for better understanding, Lord, we pray that you may open our eyes, open our ears to your understanding, Heavenly Father. Bless us, O Lord, as we continue throughout this morning in our worship through scripture. And be with those, O Lord, that are hearing us this morning, that they can also receive a blessing from you. Father, we pray that you may bless your church in the four corners of this earth as they also gather in your name, Father, to worship you. And Lord, we just pray that you may bless us throughout this time and bless all that we are doing, Lord, because we do it for the glory and for the honor of your name. And may we all be edified this morning. All this we pray and we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you for leading us in prayer. I think that it's very essential to start out with prayer because we ask God for His Holy Spirit to come on us, upon us, and to help us to meditate in His Word this morning. I want us to just consider before we start our lesson, it starts with a key verse there in Mark 16. If you want to turn your Bibles with me to Mark 16. And we're going to read there a verse, verse 6. And this is Jesus talking to his disciples once again. And it starts out like this. Don't be alarmed. He said, you are looking for Jesus the Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. Sorry, this was not Jesus talking to the disciples. This was the angel talking to the women that went to go look for Jesus.
Tenemos ahí el verso clave en Marcos 16, versículo 6. Y dice más, él les dijo, no os asustéis, buscáis a Jesús Nazareno, el que fue crucificado, ha resucitado, no está aquí. Mirad el lugar en donde le pusieron.
Great. So today is a new creation. It goes well, our lesson this week. Looking at our world today, everyone wants to belong to some way we want to belong somewhere. We're reaching out to belong. And here in this lesson this week, as I studied, I looked at our world, our nation, and I said, how wonderful it would be that everyone would look to belong to Christ, to the new creation. I want to belong to the new creation. And if that is our desire to belong to this race that Christ is leading, then this is where we want to be, with Christ. But we're going to understand more throughout this lesson. What privilege do we have today to belong to this family of God, to this race, to this nation that Christ is the head of?
Estamos mirando la lección 11 y vamos a estudiar esta mañana del privilegio que tenemos en Cristo de ser parte de esta nueva creación, de ser parte de este nuevo pueblo donde se nos abre esa oportunidad de venir y ser parte del pueblo de Dios, una nueva creación.
Yes, so we also find there key words that we're going to remember throughout this lesson. So let us consider these. If you're at home and you don't have a book, maybe you want to write them down. And it is, there are four words. And here at church, if you want to just underline them or circle them or do something where you can remember these words throughout this lesson, it is raised, newness, likeness, and live.
Tenemos palabras claves para la clase hoy en la lección. Y si tiene su cuaderno o si no tiene cuaderno, puede escribirlas. Son cuatro palabras que vamos a concentrarnos en esta mañana. Y esas son resucitado, novedad, semejanza y vida.
Yes, thank you. So if you go down with me there in your books to think about it, we're going to read a little bit on this, on these paragraphs. If you follow me there, if you're at home, just follow our reading or listen to our reading. And it starts with saying, He's alive. The tomb is empty. Christ crucified is raised. And it has exclamation points, right? Saying it very enthused. All our discussion about the cross of Christ would be for nothing if not for his resurrection from the dead. By this climactic act, the loving Father vindicates his obedient Son and validated all he was and did. Paul is emphatic on it. If Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. But he has risen. Resurrection confirms our reconciliation.
Tenemos en la parte, en el primer párrafo donde dice, mediten esto. Dice, está vivo, la tumba está vacía, Cristo crucificado ha resucitado. Todas nuestras discusiones acerca de la cruz de Cristo serían en vano si no fuera por su resurrección de la muerte. Por medio de este acto culminante, el Padre amoroso vindicó a su obediente Hijo y validó todo lo que Él era. Él era e hizo. Pablo es enfático en esto. Y si Cristo no resucitó, vana es entonces nuestra predicación, vana es también nuestra fe. 1 Corintios 15, 14. Pero Él ha resucitado, la resurrección confirma nuestra reconciliación.
Amen. And I just wanted us to consider before we go into the questions of a new creation in Christ. There is a new creation, because if we go back just a very brief history on the Old Testament, Christ had not been crucified or had resurrected. But in the Old Testament, they did, remember last week we studied about the sins of the people, how they were crucified or were supposed to bring a lamb, right? And this lamb would be slaughtered for their sins. And the blood of the lamb would cleanse their sins. Well, remember last week also, We read and said in Scripture that Jesus came and did that once and for all. So no more do we have to practice that way of doing or of getting rid of our sins. But Jesus Christ came to die for our sins on the cross. He is the Lamb that was crucified for us all.
Nomás repasando lo que habíamos estudiado el sábado pasado, veníamos comentando, ¿verdad?, de que nuestros pecados fueron clavados en esa cruz y que Cristo es aquel cordero, así como los rituales que se llevaban a cabo, los sacrificios que se llevaban a cabo en el Antiguo Testamento, que Cristo vino y derramó su sangre, así como ese cordero, para que nuestros pecados sean perdonados.
Amen. So just a review on what the Old Testament brings us. And in the New Testament today, we will study on a new creation. Who is the one that brought new creation, a new creature, a new nation, a new people to God, or God's people as we refer to it? So we want to understand this way of living, because it brings us to a memory that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And that is why we want to extend this in Scripture reading. What is the new creation, and who is the head of this new creation? How can I, you and I, belong to this new creation? Or can we even belong to this new creation? So if you stick with us throughout this lesson, you'll find these questions, and you'll want to also jot down some of the scripture readings there. And if you're here with us this morning, I encourage you to do the same. And if you have any comments or questions, you can also speak on the mic there and join us as you can also be part of this lesson this morning.
Les animamos a que nos acompañen a la lección hoy. Si tiene algún comentario, si nos está acompañando por medio del video y nos está acompañando, puede enviar su comentario a Facebook o también a YouTube, donde también podemos recibir su comentario y compartirlo con los demás. Y también si alguien aquí en la clase quiere compartir, no se detenga, sino que venga a usar el micrófono para darle esa oportunidad.
Amen. Let's go into the answer, and those are the blanks that we fill out in our lesson books. So number one reads like this: in resurrection, the Father vindicates His Son and validates all He was and did.
En la parte donde dice responda, vamos a llenar los blancos ahí. Dice la número uno: en la resurrección el Padre vindicó a su Hijo y validó todo lo que Él era e hizo. Son dos palabras: vindicó y validó.
Number two says, raised a spiritual body incorruptible. Our risen Lord is new creation.
La número dos, resucitado con un cuerpo espiritual e incorruptible, nuestro Señor es una nueva creación.
Wonderful. Number three, resurrection confirms our reconciliation.
La número tres, la resurrección confirma nuestra reconciliación. Así que le pone la palabra reconciliación.
So these are the blanks that we had, this activity that we have to do throughout the week. So if you did not put anything in there, hopefully you put in them as we read them, and you can also use it for our questions this morning. In Christ, our new lives are the resurrection story. It's what we read there. Let's do the questions. It says, talk about it. And that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to talk about it. I encourage again, once again, to, for anyone that is has a comment or a question concerning this lesson, you can do that by sending us through Facebook or through YouTube, or also you can, if you're here with us this morning, you can also speak to the mic that is before us, and you can share your comments or your questions regarding the lesson this morning. Number one says like this: how do we see new creation in the gospel record of Christ's resurrection? So we refer back to the gospels. The gospels are the beginning of the creation of Jesus Christ, because they are the ones that witnessed and walked with Jesus, and they're the ones that saw. So here in Matthew, if you turn your Bibles with me to Matthew 28, verse 1, starting with verse 1. How do we see new creation in the gospel record of Christ's resurrection? So this is the record we find here in Matthew, and it tells us like this: after the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. And there was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." Verse 8 says, "So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples."
Tenemos en la pregunta 1, dice que ¿cómo vemos una nueva creación en el registro del Evangelio partiendo de la resurrección de Cristo? Y tenemos el, versículos en Mateo 28, de los versos 1 al 8, y dice así: pasado el día de reposo, al amanecer del primer día de la semana, vinieron María Magdalena y la otra María a ver el sepulcro. Y hubo un gran terremoto, porque un ángel del Señor, descendiendo del cielo y llegando, removió la piedra y se sentó sobre ella. Su aspecto era como un relámpago y su vestido blanco como la nieve. Y de miedo de él, los guardas temblaron y se quedaron como muertos. Mas el ángel, respondiendo, dijo a las mujeres: no temáis vosotras, porque yo sé que buscáis a Jesús, el que fue crucificado. No está aquí, pues ha resucitado, como dijo. Venid, ver el lugar donde fue puesto el Señor, e id pronto y decid a sus discípulos que ha resucitado de los muertos, y he aquí va delante de vosotros a Galilea. Allí le veráis, he aquí os lo he dicho. Entonces ella, saliendo del sepulcro con temor y gran gozo, fueron corriendo a dar las nuevas a sus discípulos, y mientras iban a dar las nuevas a los discípulos.
Wonderful. There's a lot of things going on here. And a lot of things perhaps these women did not understand either. Being human, being seeing Jesus, walking with Jesus. And then all of a sudden these women come to the tomb to look for Jesus. And then an angel sitting by the tomb tells them, he's not here. He has risen, just like he said he would. So I know that there's a lot of things going on here, and then he tells them what to do, right? He gives them a direction. Go and tell the disciples. And you know what? He's already before you. He's already going towards Galilee. Wow, that's a lot of information to take from the angel telling these women what Jesus, that Jesus not only rose, he not only has risen from the dead, but he is walking, going towards Galilee. And you better go and tell his disciples because he's going over there. So there's a lot of information given here. And we see here that these women are probably confused and scared, but at the same time, joy, and they hurried away. It says that they were witness seen, that they hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to go tell the disciples. What good news! What good, how important this was for these women to witness this risen Christ, and that the angel tells them what to do next.
Miramos aquí en Mateo 28 el acontecimiento de la resurrección de Cristo. Y Daniel nos dice qué tan importante es ver todo lo que se estaba aconteciendo en ese momento. Y miramos lo importante que estas mujeres llegan a la tumba donde estuvo Cristo en el sepulcro, y que el ángel se aparece, ¿verdad? Y les da esta dirección, estas instrucciones de ir y decirle a los discípulos que Cristo ha resucitado. Y además de ello, el ángel también toma a estas mujeres, ¿verdad? Y les dice que miren, ¿verdad?, el lugar donde estuvo Jesús, que está vacío. Así que fueron también ellas testigos de esta resurrección. Y cuando ellas van y dan este anuncio, bueno, no lo dan porque se les dijo, sino que porque el ángel les había enseñado el lugar, la tumba vacía, ¿verdad? Y ellas eran testigos de esa resurrección. Y van, como dice Daniel, decía, van con ese temor, pero también dice que van llenas de gozo porque saben que Cristo ha resucitado.
Yes, just like he had told them before. And I'm sure that they kept these words in their minds and in their hearts. But yet still being afraid, being human, that's what it is, in the natural way. But there in this reading, we find something that leads us to a new creation here of Christ's resurrection. What do you see here that is new creation in the gospel of Christ's resurrection? Okay, so note that down in those verses. As we go to John 20, verse 27, this is amazing too. I like this verse here because it gives us more of an understanding. Now, we're going to take bigger steps here because we're going to further up our reading here. But in John 20, verse 27, Jesus already is going and he appears to the disciples where they're gathered. And if you read verse 27, he says, "Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe.'"
Tenemos otra escritura en Juan capítulo 20, versículo 27. Luego dijo a Tomás, "Pon aquí tu dedo y mira mis manos y acerca tu mano y métela en mi costado y no seas incrédulo, sino creyente."
Another recorded message here that we see about Christ's resurrection. When Christ was resurrected, he wasn't a ghost. That's the news. He wasn't a ghost. And we see here, because he tells Thomas, "Put your finger
here.
I mean, how many ghosts can do that? Put your finger here. See my hands? Can you see them? He tells him, reach out your hand, put it on my side. Do you remember the sign of Jesus? Why would Jesus say, put it on my side? Remember Jesus last week on the cross? That he was already dead. And there comes a soldier. And what does a soldier do?
They pierce his side.
Pierce his side. And then blood and water is pouring out. It's a symbolic, it's a symbol for us. But Jesus tells Thomas, put your finger in my side. I know what they did. Stop doubting and believe.
Miramos aquí algo importante, un buen punto que tenemos que reconocer, es que la resurrección de Cristo, miramos que cuando Él resucitó no era un espíritu, o sea, como un espanto, sino que cuando se le aparece a los discípulos y cuando se le aparece a Tomás, por eso Cristo le dice a Tomás, ¿verdad? Que venga, que se acercara y que metiera, que le tocara su costado con su mano para que pueda no nomás ver, sino que también sentir o poder ver la herida en su costado. Y es por eso que Cristo le dice que no sea incrédulo, sino que sino sea un creyente, que viniera a creer que este Jesús que fue crucificado en la cruz resucitó, pero no resucitó como algunos a veces piensan que era nomás solamente un espíritu, sino que fue tocado por los discípulos. Era algo que pudieran ellos, que pudieran tocar y poder ser testigos de esta nueva creación.
Yes, and you know what? We're gonna testify that Jesus Christ was in a ghost. Go with me to Luke 24.
Lucas 24. Vamos a mirar más ejemplos de la Biblia que nos dan de la resurrección de Cristo. Versículo 37.
It says there. This is the disciples, when Jesus appears to the disciples, and this is Luke's viewing or record of the resurrection. It says, they were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. This was the disciples. He said to them, Jesus says to them, why are you troubled? And why do you doubt? Why do doubts rise in your minds? 39 says, look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have.
Versículo 37 al 39 de Lucas 24. Dice, entonces, espantados y atemorizados, pensaban que veían espíritu. Pero él les dijo, ¿por qué estáis turbados y vienen a vuestro corazón estos pensamientos? Mirad mis manos y mis pies, que yo mismo soy. Palpad y ved, porque un espíritu no tiene carne ni huesos como veis que yo tengo.
So here we understand that Jesus' resurrection, when he comes back to life, he is flesh and bones. And they could see him, they could touch him, they could see his hands, they could see his side. So Jesus is not a ghost. He's no close to being a ghost. He comes to them, being Jesus, this Messiah, that had been crucified on the cross and told him he was going to be resurrected. So he has not been transformed, right? Because he's here with them, he's on earth with them.
Miramos entonces que en la resurrección de Cristo, cuando él viene a presentarse con sus discípulos, Miramos ahí que no fue un espíritu, sino que él tenía carne y tenía huesos, para que los discípulos fueran ser testigos de esta gran resurrección y poder tocarle a Jesús que realmente había resucitado de los muertos.
Yes, great. So here we see another gospels recorded by Luke, right, saying what Jesus had done. He had appeared to them, to the disciples again, and they were frightened because they had never experienced that the resurrection of Jesus. He had told them, but they had never experienced that. And when Jesus comes to them, he says, "Don't be afraid. It's me. Look." And he tells them again, "Believe. Don't doubt. Believe in me, what I have told you." So those are some of the things that we can take in our minds as we see the gospel records of Christ's resurrection. If you turn with me to 1 Corinthians 15, there it's going to tell us more of the things that we're looking for here. And I want you to write them down or note them down in Scripture as we read them, because they're very important. These are very important and essential for us today.
Tenemos la lectura en primera de Corintios, capítulo 15.
42.
Verso 42. Empezando
con
verso 42.
Yes, so here it goes. So you mark them down as we read them, because these are very essential for us. We're looking for a record of Christ's resurrection. And what does the Gospels tell us about this resurrection of Jesus? And here it goes. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body.
Dice el verso 40, empezando con el verso 42 y 44. Así también es la resurrección de los muertos. Se siembra en corrupción, resucitará en incorrupción. Se siembra en deshonra, resucitará en gloria. Se siembra en debilidad, resucitará en poder. Se siembra cuerpo animal, resucitará cuerpo espiritual. Hay cuerpo animal y hay cuerpo espiritual.
Wow, that says it very plain. Very, it's the old version, right? But it's called the natural, but it says the animal, the way of living, right? But here, I wanted us to note there, that today, in this world, this life that we live in, these are the words that are important in this verse, and in the verses that we read prior to this. But here is more noticeable. I want you to jot down this word, these words. There's four words here that I want us to understand. Today, we see perishable. Everything is perishable. Even us, we're perishable. We don't live forever. Flowers are perishable, trees, animals, and even us, we are perishable.
Ahorita, hay cuatro palabras que quiero yo que miramos aquí. Una de ellas es que de perecer, que hay cosas temporales. Todo lo que vemos en nuestro tiempo hoy es temporal y va a perecer.
Yes. That's in the now. If you're not in Christ, if we're not in Christ, then we're perishable. Even if we're in Christ, we're perishable. But in the new creation, if we are in Christ, because Christ is our new creation, We will be imperishable. How about that? You want to be imperishable? Not in this life, but in the life with Christ. Right? Because this life brings heartaches and we can feel the pain and everything. But you want to live with Christ forever, imperishable. In Christ, new creation. So perishable is today, but if we live in Christ, with Christ, we will be imperishable just like He is imperishable.
Tenemos la ahí la parte donde estaba diciendo Daniel que regresando un poquito a lo que estábamos platicando es la corrupción, ¿verdad? Aquello que es temporal se corrupte, ¿verdad? Pero aquellos que estamos en Cristo, entonces entramos a esta nueva vida de incorrupción. Así es que también este cuerpo de nosotros tiene que tener una transformación, un cambio, ¿verdad? Como habíamos dicho, de terminar la corrupción y poder entrar al resucitar en incorrupción.
Yes, so we must die, right?
Debemos de morir.
We must die, just like Christ died to our sins. This body is going to die, right? But if we are in Christ and we're seeking that new creation in Christ, and we live today in Christ, then we will be imperishable. We will also be resurrected, just like Christ.
Moremos de nuestros pecados, muere nuestro hombre natural, ¿verdad? El hombre animal, para que pueda entrar la incorrupción, ¿verdad? Así como Cristo murió en la cruz y resucitó, ¿verdad? Entonces, es la transformación que vemos aquí de esta nueva vida.
Yes. The other word is dishonor. How many of us have noticed that word a lot? Dishonor. There's a lot of dishonor. We won't be honored here in this world. There's a lot of dishonor. But with Christ, there is glory. With Christ, we have glory. He was dishonored. Christ, when He died on the cross, it was a dishonor for Him because He is the Son of God. So we today are in our flesh. It's a dishonor. But Christ, in our new creation, He brings glory to our lives. He is our glory. And we can also be in glory with Him today if we seek to live with Christ.
La otra palabra es deshonra. Porque dice en verso 33 que se siembra en deshonra. Mas en la vida nueva tenemos, dice ahí que resucitará en gloria. Así como Jesús, poder vivir en la gloria. ¿Verdad? Y es... Como habíamos dicho, esta vida nueva en Cristo nos permite permanecer en la gloria de Dios.
Amen. The other word is, the third word is weakness. How many of us feel weak? Weakness is part of our natural body. It's weakness, we get tired. But in Christ, there's power. In Christ, He brings power. That's the new creation. The old creation is weakness. We can't do anything on our own. But in Christ, remember that verse where it says, He has overcome the world. So if we are in Christ, we can be overcomers in this life today.
La otra palabra es debilidad. Y luego, lo positivo es poder. ¿Verdad? Se siembra la debilidad porque estamos en una vida sin Cristo, pero ahora con Cristo somos ahora un nuevo cuerpo con poder, porque la victoria la tenemos en Cristo.
Mm-hmm. New creation, remember that word, new creation. Everybody wants to enter something new. Well, here's the new. Jesus Christ is the new thing. He's the new creation. If you want something new, to belong to something new, choose Christ. He's new to the world. So He is our new creation. The last word that I want us to understand here is the natural, right? It says, it is sown a natural body. We are natural. We hurt. We have our bodies, our natural bodies. We hurt. We get sick. But look at what it says. In the new creation, it is raised a spiritual body.
Tenemos la otra palabra de cuerpo animal o cuerpo natural, y luego tenemos que somos resucitados a un cuerpo espiritual. Ya no somos parte de la familia de Adán, sino que ahora veremos ser parte de la familia de Cristo, ¿verdad? Donde hay vida, donde hay esperanza, y todo es nuevo en Cristo Jesús, una nueva criatura. Algo más que estaba mirando de la lección es de que en el estando bajo de Adán, ¿verdad? Bajo todavía del primer hombre, el primer hombre natural, Adán perdió su imagen de Dios, ¿verdad? Cuando al principio que Dios tuvo esa relación con él y que Dios dice que hizo al hombre a su imagen, ¿verdad? Ya la gloria de Dios ya no estaba en el rostro de Adán, y miramos que ahora en Cristo, Cristo vino a representar la gloria de Dios, vino a representar la honra, ¿verdad? Que se le merece a Dios, y la, como hemos dicho, la gloria, y fue ese representante de luz aquí en la tierra, y todos los que venimos bajo Cristo somos restaurados ahora a la imagen del Hijo de Dios, ¿verdad? So, miramos ahí las dos cosas, y por eso me gusta como la habíamos presentado de lo que éramos y ahora lo que somos, lo que podemos hacer, una nueva criatura. I was saying that in the, like Daniel was taking us through the different steps of who we were, or maybe where we are, and who we are now, or where we want to be now, which is this new creation. I was just adding that in Adam lost his glory, right? Because he no longer represented the creation of God because of sin, but it was marred, it was taken away. But now we see the coming of Jesus Christ, and Hebrews tells us that he was the exact representation of the Father. He was the glory of God, right, to us here on earth. And so when we come under Christ, well, that image now is restored. And now we too can reflect the glory of God, can reflect that we are children of God, and we are like Him. Right? So all of that gets restored back to us.
Yes. Restoration, that's what we talk about. Because something was wrong in the old, right? Something was wrong. So there has to be something to restore it back to its original. I like that. Restore it back to what it should be. And it is the image of God in Christ. And when we accept Christ in the new creation, when we come to be in Christ, we also reflect that glory of God. And everyone that sees us can say, that is a child of God. That's a child of God, because we reflect that. And we're going to see that more in these readings, because it takes us now to this part where Paul explains our new life in Christ. Well, how do we get there? We're talking about the new, the now and the new. How do you get there? How do we get there? How did we get here to be in the new creation? And Paul takes us through some of this. In 2 Corinthians, if you want to turn your Bibles with me there, we're going to see some of the readings there. 2 Corinthians 5.
Segunda de Corintios, capítulo 5.
And it starts out with verse 14.
Verso 14.
What a beautiful verse. And I admire it, I love it, because it tells about me. And it also tells about you. And we take it personal. And it says like this, it starts out with saying, for Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone, here it is, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sin against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. 20 says, we are therefore Christ's ambassadors. As though God were making his appeal through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. 21 finishes, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
En la pregunta número 2 dice que cómo explica Pablo nuestra nueva vida unida en Cristo y sus implicaciones. Y en 2 Corintios 5, empezando con el verso 14 al verso 21, dice, porque el amor de Cristo nos constriñe pensando esto, que si uno murió por todos, luego todos murieron. Y por todos murió para que los que viven ya no vivan para sí, sino para aquel que murió y resucitó por ellos. De manera que nosotros de aquí en adelante a nadie conocemos según la carne. Y aun si a Cristo conocimos según la carne, ya no lo conocemos así. De modo que si alguno está en Cristo, nueva criatura es, las cosas viejas pasaron, he aquí todas son hechas nuevas. Y todo esto proviene de Dios, que nos reconcilió consigo mismo por Cristo y nos dio el ministerio de la reconciliación. Que Dios estaba en Cristo, reconciliando consigo al mundo, no tomándoles en cuenta a los hombres sus pecados, y nos encargó a nosotros la palabra de la reconciliación. Así que somos embajadores en nombre de Cristo, como si Dios rogase por medio de nosotros. Os rogamos en nombre de Cristo, reconciliados con Dios. Al que no conoció pecado, por nuestros los hizo pecado, para que nosotros fuésemos hechos justicia de Dios en él.
Amen. So there we have it. Paul says that we have to be in Christ to have this new creation. We must believe in Christ, the risen Christ. We must accept that he was risen from the dead and that he is the Son of God. Those are some implications. Those are some things that Paul explains here. But we go further than that. We're going to go further than that. Not only believing and accepting Christ in our lives by word of mouth, but look at what Romans 6 tells us in verse 5. Well, you know what, we'll go we'll start with verse 1. In Romans 6. So then, Christ died for our sins so that we no longer are going to be led by sin. We are no longer enslaved to sin. You can tell sin no more. That's what we can do. And it will flee from us because we belong to Christ. We are Christ's. So then, how can we do that? It says here, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? No way, in no way. Don't continue doing that, because that's what Christ came to do for us. He came to die for you and I for our sins. to clear our record. To clear our record. So what are we to do? We are those who have died to sin. You and I have already died to sin when we believe and when we accept Christ in our lives. How can we live any longer? Then here's the important part here, another part. Verse 3. Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life.
Tenemos ahí la lectura en Romanos 6, del 1 al 5. Dice que pues diremos, perseveremos en el pecado para que la gracia abunde. En ninguna manera, porque los que hemos muerto al pecado, ¿cómo viviremos aún en él? ¿O no sabéis que todos los que hemos sido bautizados en Cristo Jesús, hemos sido bautizados en su muerte? Porque somos sepultados juntamente con él para muerte por el bautismo, a fin de que como Cristo resucitó de los muertos por la gloria del Padre, así también nosotros andemos en vida nueva. Porque si fuimos plantados juntamente con él en la semejanza de la muerte, así también lo seremos en la de en su resurrección.
Amen. So here it's telling us that Christ on the cross died for our sins. And if we too want to die with Christ, we die not in the natural way, but in the spiritual way. We don't want to sin any longer because Christ already paid that price for us. So look at what verse 8 says. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him. Verse 9 says, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. 10 says, the death he died to sin once for all, for you and I. But the life he lives to God. Verse 11 says, in the same way, in that same way, count yourselves, you and I, dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus.
Tenemos ahí los siguientes versos de 8 en adelante. Dice, así morimos con Cristo, creemos que también viviremos con él, sabiendo que Cristo, habiendo resucitado de los muertos, ya no muere. La muerte no se enseñorea más de él, porque en cuanto murió, el pecado murió una vez por todas, mas en cuanto vive, para Dios vive. Así también vosotros consideraos muertos al pecado, pero vivos para Dios en Cristo Jesús, Señor nuestro.
Amen. So we want to accept this death of Christ, and we want to die. It tells us here another part. It tells us, or do you not know that all of us were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? So there's another area here in our lives today that we can demonstrate and we show that we follow Christ is when we are baptized in water, immersed in water, because it takes away the sins. It's symbolic. It takes away our sins. And if we also go through that, we choose to go through baptism, then we show that we're dying with Christ, and then we become alive again in a new creation. We belong to Christ now. That is why when we get baptized in water, when we're immersed in water, our sins are taken away. It's symbolic, but it is true. It's something hard for the natural man to understand, because we're not there yet. But if even part of us believes in God and Christ, and we believe in the resurrection, then our next step would be to be baptized in Christ so that we can also be dead to sin and be raised again with Christ to be in that new creation. Not to be raised from the dead, but raised from our old life, our old man, to the new man. Isn't that wonderful how Christ gives us a new life, a new creation, a new nation, a new family to start up again here in this world that we live in today? We can all become new if we choose to be new in Christ.
Nomás para sumar lo que estábamos platicando es que en el verso 3 dice: ¿O no sabéis que todos los que hemos sido bautizados en Cristo Jesús hemos sido bautizados en su muerte? Y así dice que a todos aquellos que hemos venido a los pies de Cristo y hemos sido bautizados, entonces participamos en la muerte de Cristo, y porque somos participantes de esta muerte, también venimos a ser parte de la resurrección de Cristo. O sea, una nueva vida. Y es lo que ofrece Cristo. Y no es algo para el futuro, sino es algo también para el presente, que ya no somos gobernados por el pecado, sino que tenemos la victoria en Cristo para salir adelante y poder vivir esta vida nueva que encontramos solamente en Cristo. Y es por eso importante que nosotros miremos estas cosas de la muerte y resurrección de Cristo y las aplicamos ahora a nuestras vidas, que podemos decir que ya no soy lo que fui en el pasado, sino que ahora Cristo me ofrece una vida nueva, y esa solamente la da Él.
And if you go again with me to this part where it says, how and where do you see new creation evidence in the resurrection? And here it is, here is some of the evidence in what we were reading, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Again, says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. It's already been here. If you are in Christ, you are new. You're not alone. How many of us want to be new? How many of us wants to start again our lives, to erase the past? And it's like a book, right? And we want to see Daniel did all this. But when he gets baptized and receives Christ in his life, all this book is going to be erased and his life will start anew again. I mean, who wouldn't want a second chance? I know I did, and I got it. And praise be to God that you and I, you as a watching or here in our sanctuary, can also have a new life in Christ. You can be that new creation, the new start, however you want to call it. But taking Christ as our Savior and accepting that He resurrected, because here it says, therefore, if anyone, it doesn't matter who you are, anyone is in Christ, the new creation has already come to you. The old has gone, the new is here. It's here. You have started your life again with Christ, and it is where we move now in the new creation. We move to things that are imperishable, and that are glory, and that are powerful, and that are spiritual. We no longer live just in the natural.
La número 3 dice que cómo y dónde ve usted evidencia de una nueva creación de la resurrección. Y regresamos a 2 Corintios 5, 17, donde dice, de modo que si alguno está en Cristo, nueva criatura es. Y es lo que estamos mirando en esta mañana, que aquella persona, aquella alma que ha venido a Cristo, viene y recibe esta nueva creación, esta nueva vida. Y no es algo, como habíamos dicho, del futuro, sino que es algo del presente, cuando Cristo viene a transformar la vida de este pecador. Así como nosotros, cuando yo también, como dice Daniel, venimos a los pies de Cristo, y nos entregamos completamente a Él. Hemos recibido esa vida nueva, una nueva creación. Y algo más que estaba mirando, que cuando estamos en esta nueva creación, es la única manera que vamos a poder realizar y reconocer que todo lo que está aquí es temporal, porque también esperamos una nueva vida, un nuevo, como dice la Biblia, un nuevo cielo, una nueva tierra, y todo sea restaurado al fin. Y es lo que, por eso nuestra vida cristiana ya no consideramos todo como lo considerábamos antes, sino que ahora vemos por medio de nuestros ojos espirituales esta nueva creación, que ya no nos consideramos, como habían dicho a Jesús, el pastor Pablo dice, ya no lo consideramos como cualquier hombre, ¿verdad? Ahora Cristo viene siendo el Salvador, el Hijo de Dios, y es importante para nosotros como nueva creación que podemos venir también a reconocer que Cristo no nomás fue aquel gran profeta, un gran maestro, sino que es Hijo de Dios, murió y resucitó, y ahora nos ofrece a nosotros también esa nueva vida, esa nueva creación. Ya no estamos bajo Adán, ahora estamos bajo Cristo. We're no longer under the old world, the world of Adam, and it tells us there in Romans that the wages of sin is death. We're no longer in that curse, we're no longer in that old world. Now, in this new creation, through our spiritual eyes, we can see, like we were saying, that all of this is temporal, and what is awaiting us is a new heaven and a new earth. And we know that, we see that already, right? We see that that's going to come. And we see that in Christ, only through Christ, can we receive that new creation. Living it in the now, not in the future. Because now I see Christ as my Lord, now I see Christ as my hope, my Savior. And I know that with Him, He's going to come and restore all things and make them new. That's why the Apostle Paul constantly says to walk in the Spirit, to move in the Spirit. Right, because that's the kind of person that we should be now. No longer my old self like Adam, but in the walk in the newness of life.
Yes, and where we make a difference. Remember Nicodemus in John 3 where he says, what must I do? And Jesus said, you need to be born again. And he says, do I go back to my mom's womb? That was funny to me. But that is how we react sometimes, because it's the natural man. We don't understand the words, these words. But once you're in the Spirit, once you accepted Christ, you've already allowed the Spirit to work in your mind, in your heart. And it moves you forward. It moves you to another step. That is why it's important to understand the baptism is very important and essential to enter into the kingdom of God. And that is why it tells them here, you must, in Nicodemus' part, it tells them you must be born of water and of spirit. Okay, we need the water to cleanse us, it's a symbolic. But the spirit, we also need that spirit to be united with Christ. And that is why it says those things, right? But I wanted us to, in closing, to read this in 1 Peter, of what Manuel was just saying. 1 Peter 1:3, it brings us to remembrance here. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance. How many of us want to inherit? I want to be an inheritor that can never perish, that never spoils or fades. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time.
Tenemos en Primera de Pedro, capítulo 1, versículo 3 al 5. Dice, bendito el Dios y Padre de nuestro Señor Jesucristo, que según su gran misericordia nos hizo renacer para una esperanza viva por la resurrección de Jesucristo de los muertos, para una herencia incorruptible e inmarcesible y reservada en los cielos para vosotros, que sois guardados por el poder de Dios mediante la fe, para alcanzar la salvación que está preparada para ser manifestada en el tiempo postrero.
Amen. In Christ, our new lives are the resurrection story. We have a story to tell today, not tomorrow. Today, we are the story. We are the story of Christ, of that resurrection, because we are Christ's. And when we are Christ's, we have died to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus.
En Cristo, nuestras vidas son, como dice en el cuaderno, nuestras vidas son la historia de la resurrección, porque somos evidencia de que Cristo ha resucitado.
Yes, praise be to God for that. Join me in prayer. Let's pray.
Vamos a hacer oración.
Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord God Almighty, we thank you, God, for allowing us to be part of this new creation. For your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, to mark the old life that I live, that everyone lives, so that we can become new in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for this family. This family of yours, this nation, oh God, that you're preparing to gather together, that we want to be part of a nation that is not a perishable. It has inheritance, and it has glory. It has your glory on it, oh God. We just want to embrace it, Lord, and we want to accept it. We accept your Son, Jesus Christ, who was resurrected from the dead, who no longer is restrained from sin, Lord, from those powers of sin, but that is in the heavens where you're at, sitting beside your throne, because he has won victory over death. And we also, Lord, here in this earth, rejoice. And we want to, we are part of that heavenly realm, that we want to also embrace. And those of us that have not embraced it, we want to encourage through our Lord Jesus Christ to embrace his resurrection, embrace the love of Christ, so that we too can be part of the new creation, the new world, the new heavens and the new earth that are going to come. Lord, we want to embrace it all, oh God, and we want your Holy Spirit to empower us and give us the strength and courage that we need to survive in this world. Lord, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, in our lives. We ask all this forgiveness of our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to ask you to please stand. Vamos a ponernos de pie. And if you're at home, we hope that you can also join us as we worship this morning.
Galatians 2, verse 20, it says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ live in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. If you could please join us in this first song, Overcome.
Thank you.
This next song is entitled, I Love Your Presence.
Oh,
Amen. Jesus.
One last song before we conclude our morning worship, entitled 10,000 Reasons. 10,000 Reasons.
In Revelation 21, verse 4, it says, He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.
Amen. Praise God.
Yeah. We're thankful to God for allowing us to be here. Damos gracias a Dios porque nos ha permitido estar aquí. And I'm also thankful for God for those of you that are viewing us, for those of you that are following us, para aquellos que nos están viendo también. Pero muy especialmente para los hermanos que están aquí presentes, especially for those of you that made an effort to come out. I know that the Lord is pleased with our attendance, as our attendance grows gradually, and we are just honored to be in the presence of God. And I was reminded of some of these singing. The Lord tells Moses, remove your sandals because the place where you stand is holy. Cuando Dios le dice a Moisés, ¿verdad? Que se quite las sandalias porque el lugar donde él está es santo. The place is holy today as well because of his presence. Este lugar también es santo porque la presencia de Dios. And so Jesus also reminds us when he tells us, a good Samaritan woman, I tell you that the Lord, the God, is seeking for those to worship him in spirit and in truth. Le dice Jesús a aquella mujer, ¿verdad? Dios está buscando a aquellos que adoren en espíritu y en verdad. But let me tell you this morning, I think that also here we can add that the church has also worshiped in a passion form. La iglesia también ha adorado a nuestro Dios con esos cantos preciosos de una manera con amor. Vamos a ir a Dios en oración, hermano. Let us bow and go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are thankful, Lord, for allowing us to be here and be able to come and bring you songs of worship that come from our heart, Lord. And that all these words, Heavenly Father, may bring joy to your heart, Heavenly Father, and that you will also extend your merciful hand and that you will also bless your people here at this sanctuary, Lord, but also for those that are viewing us, Heavenly Father. We extend your love and your mercy for our brothers and sisters as well, Heavenly Father. But we pray especially, Heavenly Father, for those of our friends and relatives, for those of our church members that have fallen ill, Heavenly Father, we ask that you will extend your merciful hand toward them, Heavenly Lord, and that you will restore their health back, Heavenly Father. We pray for the churches throughout the land, Heavenly Lord, that we know of and have heard of their sufferings as well, Heavenly Father. We lift them up in prayer this morning, Heavenly Father. We ask that your anointing, that your Holy Spirit that is filled with power, Heavenly Father, can bring healing to your family, Heavenly Lord. We ask for your guidance and we ask for your help, Heavenly Father. And we also thank you, Lord, for another Sabbath, another time to come and just meditate on your word and also rest from our work, Heavenly Father, and rest in your arms, Heavenly Lord, as we hear your message, as we hear your calling out to us, Heavenly Father. We thank you for another day of celebration, Lord, your Sabbath. And we thank you for your blessing upon us, Heavenly Father, throughout this week, Heavenly Father, because you have kept us saved and you have provided for us. And we thank you for all those blessings, Lord. And now we also pray for all the things that we are to do here in this day, Heavenly Lord. We thank you also for allowing us to be here and making preparation for also our baptismal service this afternoon. We ask that your anointing will also be upon us, Heavenly Father, and that your Holy Spirit may embrace us with your love and grace. Forgive us of our many troubles. Forgive us of our sins, Lord, because we pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. May God bless you. May God bless you.